April 1945. The world is deep in war with millions of casualties. The United States has spent four blood-stained years fighting in both Europe and the Pacific under the strong leadership of President Franklin D. Roosevelt. FDR has been there since the beginning, declaring war on December 7, 1941, when Japan viciously attacks Pearl Harbor in an effort to sabotage the United States Pacific Fleet.
Days later, on December 11th, Hitler declares war on America. For four long years, Roosevelt leads America and her allies through the greatest war in human history. Unbeknown to the American people, his days are numbered.
The stress of war takes its toll, and the president suffers from coronary artery disease and congestive heart failure. But FDR has two secret weapons in his back pocket. The first, his new straight-talking Vice President Harry Truman. Truman will soon face his greatest leadership challenge as he tackles Roosevelt's second secret weapon, the atomic bomb, which is about to be tested in New Mexico.
Can the U.S. beat the Russians and Nazis to create the most devastating weapon mankind has ever seen? And will they use it? The decision Truman makes in the months ahead will forever cement his atomic legacy.
On April 12, 1945, President Roosevelt dies of a stroke and Truman takes office. There is no time for a learning curve, as 3 weeks later, on May 7, 1945, the war in the European theater ends when Hitler commits suicide and Allied troops conquer Berlin.
The Allies, including the Soviet Union, need to figure out how to handle the countries once conquered by Germany and start their rebuilding process. News of the imminent surrender broke in the West on the 8th of May, ending the European War, but not World War II, as Japan refuses to give up and keeps fighting. America finds itself in an overwhelming battle for a handhold over the Pacific. The Japanese are fierce, and the death toll on both sides is high. In the battles of Saipan, Leyte, the Philippines, Iwo Jima, and Okinawa, an estimated 117,000 American soldiers are killed and 253,000 are wounded. The Japanese military deaths amount to over 1,740,000 soldiers lost and 94,000 wounded.
393,000 civilians are killed in the inescapable crossfire, bombing, and chaos of war. Suicides are high. The war is getting increasingly gruesome, with 150,000 civilian deaths alone in the recent Battle of Okinawa. Truman needs to find a way to continue to fight for freedom, but limit the lives lost doing so. The answer came in something the Nazis started and America was about to finish.
In 1939, the world scientific community discovers that German physicists have learned the secrets of splitting an uranium atom. Fortunately for the United States, many of the nuclear scientists were intellectuals and also Jews, who escaped the tyranny and genocide of the Nazi regime.
Robert Oppenheimer led a team of scientists and over 3,000 employees on the mammoth task of putting all the pieces together at breakneck speed to create the bomb at Los Alamos, New Mexico.
By the summer of 1945, Oppenheimer was ready to test the first bomb. On July 16, 1945, scientists of the Manhattan Project watched the Trinity test in New Mexico, which was an outstanding success. Under Truman's presidency, the United States now possesses the first weapon of mass destruction, and the world enters the atomic age.
Truman has a difficult decision to make. Does he let the genie out of the bottle and unleash the very first atomic weapon on Japan to end the war quickly? Or does he send troops to invade mainland Japan, possibly risking more lives than if the bomb was dropped? On August 6, 1945, Truman decides to drop the bomb on Hiroshima. The bomb is nicknamed Little Boy. With the equivalent of 15,000 tons of TNT, this is the most destructive force man has ever seen.
In a city with a thriving population of 255,000 people, 80,000 people vanish as they are killed instantly. Tens of thousands of people will die later from the effects of radiation and malnutrition. Some believe the total number of casualties to be over 100,000.
With no sign of surrender from Emperor Hirohito, a second bomb, Fat Man drops on the city of Nagasaki 3 days later with even more destructive power. the equivalent of over 21,000 tons of TNT.
The city of Nagasaki, with a population of over 195,000 people, 64,000 will die from the initial blast or suffer the after effects of the bomb.
So why did Truman decide to drop the bomb? This topic has been widely debated over the course of history, but most historians believe that it was because of two major factors.
The first was to avoid a full-scale invasion of Japan, which would be a long, difficult, and costly campaign. The Japanese were already subject to constant B-29 bomber raids, which devastated the Japanese capital and other major cities. Japan was also surrounded by a naval blockade that made food and other necessities increasingly scarce. The Japanese military and civilian losses since the beginning of the war had reached up to 3 million, and there seemed no end to the bloodshed. Despite their determination to keep fighting, the Japanese mainland couldn't take much more punishment. Emperor Hirohito and his staff developed the slogan,
"The sooner the American come, the better. 100 million die proud."
This strategy was named Ketsugo, where the majority of the population was organized into one fighting force who would fight to the death. Truman's military advisors informed Truman that in order to take mainland Japan, well over 1 million more lives would be lost.
Would the bomb actually save lives? Even the scientists who created the weapon were torn by the decision. Oppenheimer himself was forever haunted by his creation.
"We knew the world would not be the same. I remembered the line from the Hindu scripture, the Bhagavad Gita. Now I am become death, the destroyer of worlds. I suppose we all thought that one way or another."
What have we done?
The second factor that led Truman to drop the bomb was to deter the Soviet Union from any rash and aggressive decisions against the free world once World War II was wrapped up. The seeds of the Cold War were developing at the Yalta and Potsdam conferences as disagreements over what post-World War II Europe should look like. Russia wanted control over countries in Eastern Europe freed from Nazi rule, such as Poland. The United States and Great Britain demanded a free Europe. Stalin stated that,
"If the United States wanted a free Eastern Europe, they would have to take it from the Red Army."
Truman's theory was that in dropping a weapon of mass destruction, the Russians would think twice before violating the terms of the Potsdam Conference.
The definition of a strong leader is one who listens to controversial points of view, looks at the data, weighs everything at hand, and then makes a difficult decision.
"It was a question of saving hundreds of thousands of American lives."
Harry S. Truman's decision to drop the bomb and wipe out two cities would have been hard for any leader to stomach. However, he did what he deemed necessary to save American lives from prolonged conflict.
The atomic bomb shortened the war, avoided the need for an invasion of the Japanese mainland, saved countless lives on both sides, and secured freedom. Harry S. Truman showed America's scientific, intellectual power and military might to the communists as the new age of the Cold War was about to commence. Truman proved to the rest of the world that America would do anything to defend the ideals of freedom against oppressors, no matter the cost. This is the legacy of Harry S. Truman.